Hello everybody, let us resume our discussion on Compton scattering. We talked about it in the last lecture, so let me remind you of what was happening a little bit. Compton was using this setup to study the property of the scattered X-rays of a graphite scatterer, and he found that there exist an elastic as well as an inelastic scattering. So these are the two peaks that he saw in his spectrometer when theta is not equals to zero, and he also found that the separation of these peaks depends on the scattering angle theta, but it doesn't depend on which scatterer he is using. It doesn't depend on which scatterer he is using and also which incident wavelength he is using. And Compton used two of Einstein's theories, the photoelectric effect light quantum hypothesis, as well as the special theory of relativity, to explain this effect of both elastic and inelastic scattering. He said the elastic scattering is happening of the electrons which are tightly bound in the core of graphite, and the inelastic scattering is happening of the electrons which are kind of loosely bound and can be treated as individual electrons. Then he said that the X-rays must have photons, X-rays should be considered as photons, and they have momentum which is h nu by c. And this momentum is given to the electrons, and because of that, the momentum reduces. And because if momentum is h nu by c, there will be a corresponding wavelength lambda of the same radiation, and that radiation, that wavelength will increase. This is where we stopped last time. Today, we'll be using Einstein's special relativity and the light quantum hypothesis to understand and to calculate what is delta lambda and see if we can explain Compton's observations. This is how Compton did. Now, to start with, let me remind you a few things from special relativity. So if a particle have mass, then its energy is related to the momentum in this following way. If it is moving non-relativistically, is moving velocity much less than c, this also will imply that its momentum, or the first term in this energy expression, is much less than the second term, and this will be the case of the electrons today for us. So for the electrons, the energy, which I can write in general, if I take the square root of the right hand side and I write m electron, just because it's the electron energy that we'll talk about. So what I do is I take m square c to the 4 outside as common, because it's much larger, so it with the square root it just becomes m e c square. So I get 1, which is coming from there, plus p square by m e square c square. And if I use the approximation is p square c square is much, much lesser than m square c to the power 4. So this quantity is much, much lesser than 1. So what will that give us? So I can again just do a Taylor expansion like we did when we were discussing special relativity. This will be just plus half p square by m square c square. So you realize that for such an electron which is moving non-relativistically with much less speed compared to the speed of light, its energy can be written as me c square plus here me, 1 me cancels out, c square cancels out. So this is the good old p square by 2 me, which is the non-relativistic kinetic energy. With that, you have to add this me c square. Okay, this we have to use in today's explanation. If I have a massless particle, we also talked about the energy momentum relation for a massless particle. And you remember the massless particle, which will be like for the photon. So let me write with the X here, which is our X-ray photons. I'm jumping from one Einstein's explanation to the other Einstein's theory. So this will be given by P times C. And if I use light quantum hypothesis here, photon energy is h times nu. So you can write the momentum of photon, for the momentum of photon, X-ray photon, I can just write as momentum or amplitude of momentum. Momentum is a vector, remember, of the photon. So what is it? This is Ex by C, which is H nu by C. Okay. So keep these two things in mind. So one is here, the other is here, and we will start using this for our scattering problem. So let's start our discussion on this scattering problem. So scattering is something we still know that the energy and the momentum will be conserved. So conservation of energy and momentum is what we will use. Conservation So for that, we consider a case or a picture before the scattering, and one picture which is after the scattering. Okay. So before the scattering, what do I have? I have this electron, and let's say that we are considering the rest frame of the electron. So the electron is at rest somewhere. This is the electron. The energy of the electron before the scattering, it's at rest, so the momentum is zero, so this is just mec square. And the momentum of the electron is zero because it is at rest. And I have the X radiation coming and falling into it. The energy of the X-ray is h nu, and the momentum of the X-ray is h nu by c, just as we have seen. Okay, so this is the picture, and let us also define our axis here, a Cartesian axis. This is x direction, this is y direction. I don't need another direction because it's all two two objects will always lie in two in a plane. What happens after the scattering? So let me draw my x here. This is my y axis, and say the scattering happens here. Okay, so we know that the x-ray goes at an angle theta. That is where we are measuring. It goes in all directions, but we are interested for the x-ray which is going at an angle theta. So this is how the x-ray is going. Okay, so what is the energy of the x-ray? Energy of the x-ray is now the frequency will change, it will reduce. That is what we discussed last time. The momentum will be h nu prime by c, and the energy will be h nu prime. Let me switch the places because I'm writing the energy up and the momentum down. Now, if the photon has gone to a direction, in the recoil, the electron has to go to the other direction. So, like it has gone, the photon has gone in the positive x-axis here, the electron has to go to the negative x-axis to conserve the momentum along the y-axis. The y-axis momentum was zero earlier. So, to conserve that, it has to go along negative x-axis. Say it goes at an angle phi. So, then, now I can write its energy, which is p square by 2me plus me c square, which is exactly what we have just calculated, and it has a momentum p, that is the momentum that it has gained. Okay, so with this much we can write down now the energy equation, so energy conservation. The energy conservation will give us, before the collision, I had h nu for the photon and me c square for the electron. After, I have h nu prime for the photon, me c square plus p square by 2m for the electron. So that's my energy conservation. You see that me c square actually can be cancelled out. So what all I have is h nu minus h nu prime. And let me multiply this by 2me. Just keep it like this. This is equals p square. This is what I get from the energy conservation. So let's use the momentum conservation now. So momentum conservation, momentum is a vector. So there will be a momentum conservation equation for the x-axis, there will be one for the y-axis. For the x-axis, before the collision, there was some momentum of the x-ray photon, but the electron momentum was zero. After the collision, both the x-ray photon and the electron has some momentum. So let's see, before the collision, all the momentum the electron had along x-axis. So this is h nu by c. After the collision, the momentum of the photon is h nu prime by c, and then x-axis I have to take the cos projection because theta, cos theta, and I also have p cos phi. So that is coming from the electron momentum. Before the collision, there was no y momentum, so that is zero. After the collision, the momentum component coming from the photon and the electron should match, because you cannot just generate the y momentum from anywhere. So we can write safely that p sine phi should be equals to h nu prime by c sine theta. Okay. Now, I do a little manipulation. So, these are all three equations that I need. So, let me put these also in box. What I want to do now is to calculate what is delta lambda prime in terms of everything else. So, what is delta lambda, which is lambda prime minus lambda. So, this is my question. So, I want to... So this will be a function of theta that I know. So I want to get rid of phi first. And it is easy to see how I can get rid of that. Because this and this, if I keep in one side, so then I will get p cos phi and p sin phi. I can square them, and cos phi and sin phi will square up to 1. So let's do that. So h nu by c minus h nu prime by c cos theta. If I square that, then in the right hand side I will get p square cos square phi, and I add to that h nu prime by c sine theta whole square. So that give me p square sine square phi. So it is basically this. Cos square phi to sin square phi is 1. Now this, if I break down, I will get h nu by c whole square. This term and this term square, once I square up, again cos square and sin square will give me 1. So let me just write that down directly, h nu prime by c whole square. Okay. And let me forcefully write a term which is 2h nu h nu prime by c square. See, this is a term if it had, then it will be h nu by c minus h nu prime by c whole square. I will like to make that up, so that's why I have just added this term. So I have to also subtract this term. That is obvious. So let me write that h nu prime by c square. But then I will get another term, which is 2 h nu prime by c square cos theta with a minus sign. So I get this. And the right hand side, what is the right hand side? The right hand side is p square. But the p square I can substitute from here. So, you see, I get very nice things. So, 2 meh nu minus nu prime. So, this is 2 meh nu minus nu prime. Very nice. Let's go forward. First of all, 1 h can go from everywhere. So, one h remains in the left hand side, which I can bring to the right hand side. So this becomes 2 me by h, and also you see I can borrow 1 c from the left hand side into here, so this just becomes 2 me c by h. Or let's borrow both the c's, so it becomes 2 me c square by h. So what remains in the left hand side? I take that H out. I'm sorry. So that H is no more there, right? So one H has got cancelled out. The other H was extra, so it has come here. So what all I have here is nu minus nu prime whole square. That is these three terms together. Plus all H and C's are gone. So this is just 2 nu nu prime 1 minus cos theta. Let's divide everything by nu nu prime and multiply by h by mec square. So I'm just playing with terms now. So h by mec square into nu minus nu prime whole square by nu nu prime. I have divided by that. Let's keep the 2 also here. Plus, so this once I divide, so nu nu prime goes away, the 2 goes away. So what I will get is h by mec square only. One minus cos theta. In the right hand side, I have nu minus nu prime by nu nu prime. Okay, things are taking shape slowly. So let's see what we will get. First of all, nu minus nu prime is very small. There is not much shift actually in the Compton shift. The shift is actually very small. So I can neglect nu minus nu prime square. This can be neglected with respect to nu nu prime. So this term I don't need to carry anymore. I have to just write the other two terms. So let's do that. You also see this I can write as 1 by nu prime minus 1 by nu. So 1 by nu prime minus 1 by nu becomes h by mec square into 1 minus cos theta. And then I multiply both sides by c. C by nu prime is nothing but lambda prime. C by nu is lambda, which is the shift that we are talking about. It's essentially h by mec into 1 minus cos theta. So this tells us now how much is the expected shift or difference between the two peaks in the Compton spectrometer at a given scattering angle theta. If you calculate h by mec, the value of this, this comes out to be 0.024 angstrom. This has a name. This is called Compton wavelength. and you immediately see it's a combination. It is calculated out of combination of three fundamental constant, h, mass of electron, and c. So this is essentially independent of the incident lambda. And this immediately solves one of the observation of Compton. So trying to use Compton's scattering formula that we have just got to explain Compton's wavelength shift, let's ask the question, how much shift that is expected to be seen? At different values of theta. So delta lambda, we realize, is proportional to 1 minus cos theta. The proportionality constant is the Compton wavelength, which is often called also lambda c. Independent of anything. So how will this look like? So as a function of theta, how will delta lambda look like? Well, at theta equals to 0, cos theta is 1. So 1 minus 1 is 0. So I get this point here. And as you can see, it will keep on increasing. What will happen at theta equals pi? Cos theta is minus 1. So 1 minus cos theta will be 2. So that will be maximum value of this, and then again it will decrease. So this will be at theta equals to pi. So maximum change in wavelength is h by mec. And then 1 minus cos theta becomes 2, so this is 2h by mc. So what is the maximum reduction of the photon energy? Well, that happens. So this is delta this will happen for delta nu max. So this I can write as h delta nu max. And if I divide it by h nu, that will give me, so the maximum is here. This is the fractional change, maximum fractional change with respect to the original frequency. And you will agree that this will be delta lambda max by the original lambda. That's it, how differentials are related, right? This now delta lambda max is 2h by mec, and I can write lambda as c by the original wavelength nu. So this quantity, fractional change, maximum fractional change, in X-ray energy because of Compton scattering is given by 2h nu by m e c square. Okay, you see, m e c square is photon, it's 0.5 MeV. If you calculate in electron volt unit, it is 0.5 electron volt unit, mega electron volt unit. So only if your photon energies are of this order, then you will be able to see the Compton effect. If we consider optical photon, then this fractional change will be how much? The fractional change will be, so this, let's call this delta E. Usually for all photon or radiation related thing, so it's written with a suffix gamma. So gamma stands for of radiation. So this is the fractional change of energy of the radiation. In this particular case it is X-ray, but it can be anything. So if you consider it's a fractional change with respect to the optical photons. Now the optical photons h nu is of the order of few electron volts. So this will be of the order of 10 by 0.5. The fractional change will be this, which is of the order of say -4, and that is extremely difficult to measure. For X-rays, which is, you see that the X-ray, the wavelength that is used is of like 0.1, near to the it's near to this 0.5 MeV. Because of that, you can see Compton effect for the X-rays. Now this also explains why you don't, why that elastic peak appears. Remember that Compton was always seeing this lambda equals to zero peak. It was always present. Why is that? And remember Compton's explanation, that is coming from this core, the electrons in the graphite core. Now for the electrons in the graphite core, the effective mass is that of the graphite. So at least you can think of mass of one proton. So for the core electrons, effective mass is of the order of the mass of the proton. So if I calculate now Compton shift for the proton, so remember that Compton wavelength for the proton, the Compton wavelength formula is h by mec. Now in place of e, I have to write proton mass. So this is h by now mpc. If you calculate, see, mp is like 1.67 into 10 to the minus 27 kg. Electron mass is 9.31 into 10 to the minus 31 kg. So this of the order of 10 to the minus 30, this of the order of 10 to the minus 27. So mass stays in the denominator. So this Compton wavelength, instead of 0.024 angstrom, it will be 10 to the 3 times smaller. And remember that the maximum shift is just 2 times the Compton wavelength. Maximum shift is just 2. There's one more thing which we can discuss is we can ask the question. What is the fractional energy loss of the photons? It will be same. I can also say what is the fractional energy gain of the electrons. Now remember, we calculated something similar, but this is maximum fractional change. Now we are talking about what is the fractional change. To calculate this, what we can do is we can do H delta nu by H nu. Delta nu is nu minus nu prime, and H nu is just H nu. So H by H nu. Nu I write as C by lambda minus C by lambda prime. So this is HC by H nu lambda, sorry, lambda prime minus lambda my lambda into lambda prime. Now this lambda I can again write C by nu, which cancels this. H also gets cancelled out. So this is essentially delta lambda by lambda prime. So this let us call this delta E by E of the photon. So let's write X. X stands for the X-ray. It's not the maximum value, it is any value. So this lambda prime is lambda plus delta lambda. So this is this. So this I can write. So delta lambda is, remember, lambda C Compton wavelength into 1 minus cos theta. And here it is lambda plus lambda C into 1 minus cos theta. So this is a more general expression for the fractional loss in the photon energy, or you can say gain in the electron energy. Okay. So that is the final formula that we'll discuss today. Today's lecture was rather a little short one, but what we have come to know is about the Compton effect and how Compton used two of Einstein's hypothesis to tell how the Compton effect, the inelastic peak scattering peak, can be explained. And he calculated the Compton wave, Compton shift. And actually, when if you actually put in his observations at 45 degrees, 90 degrees, and 145 degrees, they fall exactly on the theoretical curve of delta lambda proportional to 1 minus cos theta. Thank you. I'll stop here today.